administrative students who are here, as well as the law students, they have a background that before any training and development session takes place, there is a proper manpower mapping, which is done before job analysis is first done in any kind of a job, where they identify the different characteristics with regard to the job description and the specification. And then subsequently, there will be various ways in which training and development can be rendered to all its employees. I think there is some issue with regard to somebody else's presenting. May I please request all the participants not to present? Can the technical team help me out with this?
Yes, ma'am.
I think somebody was presenting. I think now it's clear. I would request all the participants, as laid down by Dr. Jenna, please kindly keep yourself in mute mode, or please do not make any presentations while the classes are going on, and then we can subsequently take your doubts after the class. Now, when we were discussing about training and development, if we talk about industrial revolution, we have been through a lot of evolutionary process. Now, evolution in the terms that when we talk about how industrialization came in and how things started about, we initially started with manufacturing sector to be the boost in industrial revolution. Now, when we talk about industrial revolution, manufacturing, if we go back to the earlier dates when the era where scientific methods were used for recruiting people, we had F.W. Taylor's scientific management, who said about right people at the right people for the right job. Now, at that point of time, because there was assembly line production, the only way people got into work was through assembly line. And from that stage to today, we have evolved gradually, where from gate hiring, they first understood that post-gate hiring, there are a lot of challenges. What kind of challenges? The challenges were, now when you gate hire, so you'd randomly, whatever is your requirement with regard to the manpower, you allow only those many people to enter your workplace. Now there is no skill, and there is some sort of a mechanical work that has been assigned to you, which only takes into consideration the speed in which you do the work. Now keeping that in mind, from that stage, people realize that it is a long, lengthy process, and for the first time, documentation was done. Now, in this documentation, registration of people or the workers who were earlier working in that particular department or that particular factory or that manufacturing unit were taken in, and every time there was nobody else who was trying to initiate any sort of a training to them. Now, post that, we entered an era where this simple documentation went forward to the rights of the laborers. Now, rights of the labor class entitled something where came in a new department called as labor welfare. Now, from labor welfare, and if we see, look into the legislations of India specifically, these are all British legislations, be it the Trade Union Act of 1927, Industrial Dispute Act, early legislations which have started, of course, with a lot of changes or amendments that has taken place. Now, here, what I wish to say is, now, from the labor welfare department, it emerged as a personnel management as a department where it initiated studies with regard to understanding recruitment, human resources, recruitment selection. Now, from HRM, we moved to a state where we have, from personnel management, we moved to a state that we call as HRM. Now, today we are in a state where we call something HRM, and most of the MBA courses, wherever the top B schools, be it IIM, ABC, wherever we look into the course outline, most of them offer a course that is called as SHRM. Now, what is SHRM? Strategic Human Resource Management. Now, why the word strategic has been implemented along with HR? Because it has evolved over the eras where people have understood the importance of human capital, human assets, humans as assets, and how these assets can be utilized at the maximum potential for any organization. Now, keeping all this in mind at the background, now we move on to the training and development session, where I will be presenting a slide here. You can refer to the slide presentations here. Just quickly, yeah. Is my slide visible?
No.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
It's visible. Training and development.
Yeah, training and development. Yeah. Now, here in this. Yeah, visible to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I'll just put the. Yeah. Now, when we talk about the learning outcomes, what are we going to take away from this particular 1.5 hour class? We will understand the definitions of training and development. We will understand the nature of training and development, how it has been evolved. Now, very importantly, we will be understanding the various contemplating constructs, that is training, development, and education. We will also look into the need assessment of training. What are the reasons why need assessment has to be done. We will look into the various kinds of training being meted out to the employees, where I will give you a lot of examples of various companies where training takes place and the best practices. We will also discuss what are the challenges that happens when we talk about training and development. Now, firstly, going to the definitions of training, education, and development, all three of them, I would not be reading out the slides, so this is just for your clarification, but I would be explaining, so you can take notes of it. When we talk about these three constructs, training, education, and development, we can differentiate these three constructs with regard to various parameters. Now, what are these parameters? The parameters could be content. When we look into the content or the construct of these three, we can say that training and education are very much overlapping to a certain extent. But then there is a difference when we say about training and education. Training is very importantly targeted to a particular situation or for a current requirement of the organization. Education is very much there in every process of learning and sharing of knowledge. Now, over the years, and it is much more systematic. Now, how far you are being, how much do you take in? It depends upon you. Like right now, I can say, for example, with a lot of problems that we all are facing with regard to the online education pattern. So we as teachers, as stakeholders with regard to imparting education, we are giving, trying at least our best in giving it. Now, people in the participants or in the groups of various forums, it depends upon them how much they can take it and then utilize it in their own ways. Whereas development, on the other hand, now when we talk about development, it is it aims for the future. Now, how it aims for the future, it is of a longer duration and it is much more proactive. Why proactive? Because it meets future needs. Now, let me tell you very honestly, when we start studying or learning any particular construct, we try to do a bit of research with regard to a background as to when did this construct come up? Why is this called training? Why is it different from education? Why is it different from development? What are the points of similarities? What are the points of differences? Then, apart from understanding the theories underlying this three, how can we practically make usage of all these three together so that what is the end result? The end result is, can we apply this in our day-to-day life? Like education would be, which has a systematic pattern of 10 plus 2 plus 3 plus, your professional courses or whatever, the education pattern which goes in a system. But then training is given for a specific problem or for a specific situation, but a specific incident. How do you execute it? So for that particular training is being given. Development is how will you use this particular skills that were given to you in the training mechanism for the future needs of the organization. So I think that will make the difference between training, education and development very clear with regard to how its execution happens. Now coming to understand training, we need to understand what are the outer layers and the core competencies involved. Now when we talk about resources, we have humanware, orgoware and infoware, which are all involved important beings when it comes to training and development. When we talk about humanware, we have workers, supervisors, managers and other employees. Now let me tell you very specifically, now when it comes to blue collar workers, there is a different set of trainings being imparted to them. The white collar workers, which have again the categorization done in your like if you have already covered the module with regard to manpower planning, manpower mapping, recruitment selection, and depending upon your job profile, what training is to be given to what level of employee, what job profile is understood from the humanware with regard to the categorization of the work you are doing, which is there mentioned in your job description. Now, when we talk about orgoware, it is the materials, machinery, money, infrastructure, and organization. Now, for a particular university, apart from the students and teachers and the staff, which are a part of the humanware, we have orgoware, whereas where we have proper books facilities, whether there is e-library given, whether that is money flowing in from the government or from the the other ways of sponsorship. Is there a proper infrastructure with regard to the execution of this kind? And organization is a combination which has both humans as well as humans become an integral part, definitely, but the overall framework is a part of an organization. Now infoware, which is with basically with regard to your brainstorming with regard to your knowledge, skill and technology which is required for any sort of a training, development or education to be imparted. So these three become your important resources. Now when we talk about human resource management and training, you first need to identify what is the profile, what is the background and what is that person required to be educated for, what are the roles. Now that's the reason why companies, be it any form, be it a startup or be in an established company, the first thing that is done in a company is to identify the structure and hierarchy of the organization. And every you take in any company, just Google the company and go to the organization's website, you will see there is a structure of the company where they have a drop down menu called as home and people. So you know exactly what is the framework. Who is there at the strategic level? Who is there at the tactical level? Who is there at the operational level? What are the roles associated with each and every profile? What is the specification? What is the eligibility criteria for every job profile? So that is discussed. And that is very much important when before training is being meted out. Now, training also takes into account the practical and the procedural adoption of the sector. Now, keeping in mind, now, say, for example, if I think of meting out, training, there are a lot of independent as well as interdependent departments or functionalities which happen. Now, I have to, when we talk about labor laws, what is the new amendment coming in with regard to, the migrant worker, which is going to take a huge shape or a UN cry post this COVID-19 issue is being resolved. The next big thing that any nation or specifically India, we are going to face is what are the rights of the migrant workers? How do you adopt it? What kind of training were they given? Now we see what are the UN cry, we see all the challenges happening. Whether the government is in a financial state, whether the company is in a financial state to bring in these kind of trainings, keeping all the change in background that is happening. Now, with regard to documentation also, training is very much important. Now, I think most of the MBA students are very much aware, or for that matter, administrative people are very much aware that documentation is a very important process with regard to any sort of a system to be processed. Now, when we talk about documentation, before training program also takes place, every department, that HRM department, has a training and development section, which is an allotted budget. Now, this budget has to be utilized. For that, what is the amount that is allotted? How many programs can be taken up in that budget that has been assigned by the company? What kind of training programs? So all the documentation has to be done thoroughly with regard to the trade world. Then we come to what are the basic skills required and what are the flexibility which would be a part of the disciplinary process with regard to training factors. Now, once this training is being conducted, and we will get into the details of how training and how need assessment is done. But once this training, budgeting, documentation is done, we also take into account that how is it going to help in four different criteria in decision making. Once this training is being meted out, like I'll give you an example, people here who are from academic background, they can very well understand when we say that, you know, when if you have any idea about statistics, now we, apart from SPSS, we have now upgraded ourselves to R. Now through R, what are the different, you know, pinpoint exact differences we see in the statistics? How is that going to help in the decision making process? Now, how is that whatever training that we have been attaining and the company is sponsoring for us, how is that going to help in problem solving? How is crisis management going to happen? Now, if I talk about crisis management, the best site that you can look into is the NDRF team that we have with regard to the disaster management scheme. So there you will have different set of guidelines that how they keep into account various ways of training and development in different with regard to different kind of disasters. What could be the possible disasters? How do you manage everything? Is and this becomes one of the important criterias with regard to development. Now, workforce devising, here you play a major bridge between the employer and the staff. Now, why development? Because say, for example, at this point of time, when as a employer as well as an employee, you are both contributing towards the growth of the organization. There are different personality types who will perceive this in a very different way. But say, for example, how are you contributing? Is it okay that you are at home and we are not putting in our efforts? Or is it that being at home also, we are contributing for the growth of the organization? So it is a mutual way of the staff and the employees. Now, what are the different organizational needs for training? Now, for organizational goals and objectives, training is mandatory. Now, if you need to go for backward forward integration, if you need to come up with a new technology, if you need of bringing up yourself up to the mark with regard to your competitors, training is a definite requirement. We also have, very interestingly, if you look into the third point, exit interviews. Now, companies today, earlier, where workers were giving in to the vulnerability, now today we have reached to a stage where if you have that asset to the company, if you are contributing as an engaged employee, or the culture of the organization is such where your employer itself says that if this person is an asset to the company, if this person is giving in so much to the company, why is it that he or she is leaving the organization? What were the reasons for which the person is deciding? Is it because of a career prospect? Is it because of the company policy? Is it because of the lower perks? Is it because of the lack of incentive mechanism? So from the exit interviews, they try to tap what are the possible problems. Now, this also helps with regard to your training sessions. Now, management by objective, construct coined by Peter Drucker. This also brought in a new concept of training, that how step by step you can go about training mechanisms. Total quality management, we will discuss about this in the future slides. Then we have customer service and current and future changes. Now for this particular organizational need, now if we look into today's scenario, the only market where we can see people are, you know, engaging is pharmacy and basic minimal needs that they are focusing on. And of course, because we are all staying connected through telecom or through, you know, the electronic means, these are the three sectors which are booming at this point of time. Now, if we look into this picture, what kind of training? Now, say, for example, a lot of us who are, very much like comfortable with online teaching. So there are different ways of online teaching. It could be Google Meet. It could be WebEx. We have, I just ventured into something. I think GNLU has come up with Cisco, tied up with Cisco. They have this WebEx thing which is coming up. Then we have a lot of future things which is coming on with keeping the current situation in mind. Even with regard to pharmacy, COVID hospitals that is very much dedicated to treating COVID patients. We can also try to find out what is the training being given to the resident doctors or what kind of, you know, people who are in the front line, how are they managing, what kind of training instructions is being given, who is executing it. So all this becomes important when you are actually working in an organization. Now, examples of organizational needs, new products that are being sold or being made. If you are manufacturing a new product or you're thinking of bringing in that product into the market. So how, now here I can give you the example of Britannia. Britannia biscuits, which were a monopoly in the market at a long time, was baffled when, ITC, the Sunfeast thing came in. So when launch of a new product comes in, what are the requirements with regard to training and services that has to be taken into account? New technology has to be introduced. Everyone is now in a learning process that how can I adapt to the new technology so that things might be easier. Now, I remember when we used to you go for sample surveys, a lot of you can relate. Some people even go to the field with, we had those bigger chart papers where we used to, list all the respondents' name and then fill in accordingly. But now we have Google Forms there. We have different ways of survey mechanisms in which we can take help of technology. New legislations. Now we saw a new array of legislations coming in. Like, say, for example, the RERA Act, which came in. Post that, what kind of a change is happening in the real estate market? So all this requires training and development. Now here, very importantly, we should also take into account the acquisition, mergers, disposal, and structural changes. Now this is something that people would not want to talk about, but say for example, the recent Vodafone and Idea merger that had happened, post that a lot of issues which came in, what kind of sensitivity training was given to the employees of both Vodafone and Idea? What kind of issues were resolved? How many people were laid off during the process? So, which we will subsequently read, and redeployment and reskilling. So all this are important parts which comes to training and development. Now in the training process, assessment of the training needs is a mandate. Without assessing the needs, you cannot start a training program. You would need to identify what are the objectives of my training. Now, say for example, how you can see this? Now, if you have heard about something called as performance appraisal. Now, post a appraisal or a review, every person or an individual reporting to his or her boss, they have a review appraisal mechanism where they will be given a feedback as to how did they perform. Now, if the performance lacked because of a particular training not being given to that individual, so you identify the training need, then give that training, and post giving that training, again do reassessment of the work or the performance by the individual. And then check whether the individual has performed better or not performed better. If he has performed better, that means the assessment of the training objectives and meeting the training objectives has been satisfied. If it has not been met, then you need to entirely restructure the training need and the assessment thing. Now that's the reason why in the implementation process and the evaluation process, frequent reviews are a mandate with regard to training and development. Now, I'll also tell you, like, depending upon the job profile and the organization, now, if you look into any of the websites of the top B schools in India, ABC, IIMs, you will see a lot of consultancy programs running through most of the IIMs. And that is a major source of economy for most of the IIMs, because most of the top-notch companies have tied up with them to give them management development programs, executive development programs. Now, let me tell you, EDPs, that is executive development programs, are for the strategic level managers. For the MDPs, they have the middle-level managers and the other managers involved. Now, subsequently, you have PSUs also who have tied up with all these organizations so that they can also give training to the frontline or the operational level managers. Now, say, for example, when Jio launched into the market, it came into the market with a complete different technology. Now, because of a complete different technology, it requires training. Now, if that training is not being given to the frontline managers, how are they going to execute it? So for that subsequent keeping yourself in a loop of the training need, objective, feedback, again, reviewing. So that becomes a mandate when it comes to the training process. Now, who are the stakeholders in the training program? There are trainers, trainees, designers, and evaluators. All of them play a major important part. Even with regard to the designer, how, like, if you are doing, like, say, for example, I would take an example of, say, from my law school, where we teach contracts. Now, contract law, when taught in class, how is it being executed? For that, we require contract drafting. So if you are creating a course, which is like a certificate course on contracts, so it could be a combination of both theory and the execution. If not, the evaluation pattern would be defective. It would only simply relate to an education process. It will not lead to the developmental needs of the organization. So combination of theory, practicality, and its execution is a mandate for all the stakeholders involved in the training process. Now, there are various, coming to the different types of training, there are various on-job and off-job mechanisms. Now, when we talk about on-job training, there is job rotation. Now, job rotation, remember, is always in the same profile. If you have visited a bank, so you have seen, in the first week, you would see a person in job rotation or in the same profile in the customer service. And then subsequently, you would again visit the bank next week. You would see the same person who was there in the customer service in the cashier counter. So there is a job rotation in the internship level or the initial level with regard to, you know, understanding how different departments function. Now, job rotation, again, depending upon the profile and the skills, will where job rotation can be possible, cannot be possible, is again, a question or a call taken up by the management. Coaching is definitely one of the major things. That's the reason why we have, consultants, like top MNCs. If you ask me, it is Amazon, or with regard to Google, or with regard to your iPhone. All of them have a complete mentoring process with regard to constant coaching, with regard to, you know, what are the, apart from the skill-based, they require psychological counseling is also meted out to them. Now, job instruction is where step-by-step every function is being given to you with regard to training process. I'll give you a simple example. Say, for example, you want to install a new app in your laptop or your phone. So the command, it's just like everything is coded by the technicians. So they give you start, then next, then next, then next, follow up, finish. So job instruction is very similar pattern, where step by step you follow every pattern of doing things. Committee assignments, where you give kind of a combined training to a group of individuals, where you give them problems, or be it, you know, any sort of a simulation that how can go about doing it. Now, there is something called as internship training also, which my law students as well as people from MBA background, they can very well understand that during an internship report is being submitted, where we get the practical experiences of working in a law firm or be it in a company, and then we have to give a report to both the organization for which we might be paid a stipend, or to the place, to the university itself, which also has an evaluation mechanism. Off-job training methods, they include case study. Case study, like management people, most of, the problems or, the practical orientation is done through case study. And the best thing is Harvard case studies, which are, even though very lengthy, you would get the practical experience as to how a problem, what kind of a problem might arise, what are the different parameters of the problem, what are the subsequent problems, and how do you come up with a solution to these problems. Critical incident method is, again, a situation-based or a contingency of job training, that how would you, react, or how would you execute yourself in a particular situation. Role play is where you identify yourself as employees or stakeholders or other people involved in the thing, and then try to execute the work. In basket is something which is a fancy term used for it. It's basically where, all grievances or problems with regard to any sort of a company is put down on your desk and you try to resolve one by one. Business games is often a common technique used in almost every B school. Grid training, this concept called as grid was taken from managerial grid by Blake and Morton. Now, this again has 9:9 or 81 ways of identifying of job training mechanisms. Lectures is where we are doing right now, where I'm constantly interacting. Obviously, one-way interaction is happening. We'll take your subsequent answer questions in the towards the end of the session. Simulation is where a work-like situation is being created. Now, almost all, for example, IT companies go for simulation technique. Now, if you see most of the IT companies, direct recruitment where they happens, when they go to the campus and do direct recruitment, now they select the people required, and then they sign a contract. Please ensure that in the contract it is very clearly written, even if you are taken in, you need to complete the 3 months training period, and then only geographical location or preferences will be taken, and then you can take up the job. So in the first 3 months, a simulation training is being given to them. And only if you qualify in the simulation technique, you can move on to the next step. And they are very strict. Like, so for example, the best kind of training meted out is by TCS, Infosys, Wipro when it comes to simulation exercises. Management education and conferences are also the off-job training methods which are taken in by companies. Now, what are the challenges? Now, when we talk about challenges in training, the first kind of a challenge we face is training is never taken that seriously when it comes to, whenever there is an economic slowdown or whenever there is a recession happening, the first thing that will be given, the leverage will be that, okay, the training for the session is postponed till further notification comes in. So this is a major criteria. And there is a lack of commitment and involvement among the executives that, there should be a spark within that. If you want to learn something, you will have that inbuilt within you, irrespective of any situation you are facing. So that is somewhere lacking within the executives. Obviously, it depends upon the organizational climate, but it has a major reinforcement factor. Now here, the problem also lies is, now, be it a private firm. Now, you need to understand these challenges, keeping the government and the public and the private sectors. When it comes to private sectors, they have a very, very clear criteria when it comes to training and development. They will give you all the incentives, but they will ensure also you're giving it back to the organization, which is very much not executed well in a public organization. Very few are exceptions, but then a participant or the employee needs to be accountable that at least if my company is investing or thinking that I have the potential that I can learn something new and give it back to the company, we should be accountable for it. If that accountability is not there, and I'm sorry, be it in public and private, it is very difficult to work in this kind of a situation. Now we move on to the next topic, that is redeployment and reskilling. And very, I went through the blocks of Orissa State Open University, which focused on a few legislations. But I would definitely ask you people, apart from reading the block, please relate to the different legislations with regard to redeployment and reskilling. Now, why this two words may sound really fancy or very much up to date with regard to the managerial terms, but we need to understand the rights with regard to redeployment. Now, when we talk about redeployment, what exactly does it mean? Redeployment is a process of moving people within the organization from units, and where there is an excess or a surplus, and where do they move them? To places where there is shortages. Now, this is a very clear thing that they have mentioned. But say, for example, if there is a merger, if there is an acquisition, if there is a disinvestment happening, and that's exactly where you face the problem of dealing with your employees. Now, how would you move in? The redeployment factor, why did it fail? When the question of redeployment comes in, that means there was something wrong with regard to your manpower mapping and planning. Manpower mapping and planning means at the beginning, when you thought of coming up with, these many people will be required for this many department, this will be the structure of the work, this will be the profile of the work. So you had identified at the very beginning. And for that, there are different methods, right? You take in subject matter experts or experts in that field who would get into that area and try to give you the exact calculation that how many manpower is required and what is the skill required for executing that kind of a work. If that has failed in the beginning or there has been an economic deprivation or there has been a backward forward integration, or there has been an economic slowdown, or the entire industry has transformed itself, then only the question of redeployment happens. Now, redeployment, which has different guidelines, I think this guideline is not being mentioned in the blog. I would request all of you to please go back and look into the guidelines, because the guidelines are very important with regard to retooling. Like say, for example, if a particular employee is given an option of redeployment, what is the period of time mentioned? What is the skill specification? What is the date of joining with regard to the new rules and regulation? What are the skills and competencies with regard to the new regulation of the new redeployment? Even if it may show that right man for the right job, employees need to be very, very clear with your rights. I will give you instances. The reason management gives is for redeployment benefits are skills are retained and additional cost to the recruit is not lost. Now, management will always try to save the money with regard to, the first one, why does this question arise that additional cost will not be incurred? Only if the company is going for a backward forward integration. That means you are expanding your group. Either you are expanding towards a new, with the parent group, you are expanding with a subsidiary, or you're going for backward integration. That's the reason why you might require, people from this particular parent company to move into the new subsidiary company. That could be a possible for where you might take the help. But what if there is a merger? What if there is a, amalgamation happening? So for that, how do you relate to all these things? Reskilled staff, they have greater display of engagement. Again, I have doubts with this. The reason being, why do they display greater engagement? Is it because of fear that they might lose out on the job? Or is it because they are motivated enough with a new prospect of the backward forward integration? So these are always, the jargons expressed by management. But the first and foremost thing, when redeployment word itself is used, the first thing that employees need to look into is the rights. And you will look into the Ministry of Training and Personnel and Training. You would have different set of guidelines. For the Indian Railways, we have different set of guidelines. And what are the service rules? What are the labor laws involved with the redeployment thing that has to be analyzed first? Now, issues, laws, as I said, laws pertaining to redeployment, public and private service rules. Now, public, obviously, because they are being answerable to the government and they have a larger stake, definitely the rules are to be taken into picture. Now, when we talk about private players have the service rules and regulations very much intact. So any employee going for redeployment or reskilling need to look into the service regulations with regard to these cases. Now, with regard to cases pertaining to redeployment, I would cite a few cases. One is, I would give the references of it to Dr. Jenna. You can look into Punjab National Bank and the All India New Bank case. It was a case in 1997. The Hindustan Lever and the Hindustan Lever Employees Union, that case which came up in 1999 and was taken up to the Supreme Court. Then again, in very recent, we have the Central Administrative Tribunal. We had a lot of cases with regard to the discrepancy with regard to redeployment. So those cases, please look into any of the sites with regard to recent cases with redeployment and the guidelines for it. You can understand it better. Now, before ensuring redeployment, these are a few checklists that any organization needs to look into. HR people who are not aware of legal cells. So everything has to be in coordination with regard to the legal cell of the company. So it has to be carefully reviewed, and managers need to be trained and before the implementation happens. Now, employee appraisals detailing has to be taken into picture. Shortlisting as who would be the risk people involved in the risk and all these redeployment, that has to be taken into consideration. Now, if the person has to be given a choice. Now, very recently, if you are aware, your Indian Oil has said, because of the COVID situation, and it is quite obvious, if a company is not doing business in a where there is a cessation of work with regard to strike or with regard to any other contingencies, economic slowdown or with the recent COVID thing that is happening, and the business is not coming in that way. So keeping those things in mind, companies today, I think, have also issued VRS, that is the golden handshake, that is called as voluntary retirement scheme. If the redeployment scheme is not working, which will not work, because in this situation, if the revenue is not being generated, their companies will go for layoffs and retrenchment, as mentioned in Industrial Dispute Act in 1947. So you will get into the details of it. So everything here is interlinked and dependent. So when you are using the redeployment word or you are enforcing redeployment, you have to take into consideration all of this, all the stakeholders at risk, and then give equal opportunity to everyone. Now we move on to the third topic, that is total quality management. Now total quality management, we talk about, total makes the whole world. Quality, which talks about degree of excellence and a product, excellence of a product or the service that is provided, and then management, as we all know, planning, organizing, directing and controlling for effective and efficient use of all the resources. Now, keeping all this in mind, when we talk about TQM, it is a continuous and sustainable way of improvement of both individuals, groups and the whole organization, be it with regard to your quantity, quality and the kind of work you are doing, which involves not only the monetary, but also the human aspect to the developmental process. Now, without understanding these theories, total quality management will be very difficult. We have Deming, who was considered to be the father of quality management. Edward Deming was the Japanese American scientist, statistician, in fact, who started working with Japan. Now, the concept of total quality management, as we talk about, the first generated during the Second World War, when there was a lot of manufacturing happening with regard to your weapons and for the defense mechanism, what were the for that mass production was happening. And Deming was the one who was helped revive Japan with post the Second World War. And it was Deming who brought, you know, the concept of total quality management from the, you know, Japan to the outside world, along with Juran and Crosby. Now, when we talk about Deming, I had written a paper about it, which talks about how Deming's principles are relevant in today's times, when he talks about people should not focus on quantity, but they should also keep in mind the quality. So in the 14 principles of Deming, you can clearly understand that how quality circles are being created. And very importantly, Deming was the first one that the very beginning, he introduced the concept of, apart from quantity, he used that human psychology has also to be understood. So, when a statistician who is only associated with numbers talks about, you know, the human importance, it makes a lot of difference with regard to, the execution of the work in terms of quality and quantity. Juran was Joseph Juran. He was first employed with the Western Electric Company. And he talks about that he was more quantitative in nature, most of his principles, which spoke about the cost of poor quality. Now, if it is of a poor quality thing, then it will not sustain itself in the market, then it would, again, the cost with regard to it will also go up, and there will be a lot of liabilities on the company if you are producing poor quality products. So he developed a quality trilogy at the operational level, which focused on quality planning, quality control, and quality improvement. These were the three things that Joseph Juran had spoken about. Crosby, on the other hand, focused on something called as zero defects. Now, very interestingly, there's a very funny anecdote which talks about that, Crosby was, he was so much, obsessive or, compulsive about the word zero defects. Like if a company gives you an order that, say, 1,000 products are the requirement of my company, and a permissible of 10 defective products is okay, right? So they give the, I'm talking about at that point of time. So Crosby was the one, when the finishing of the product was done, every detail mentioned in the consignment, 1,000 exact perfect products along with the zero, the 10 products were also given back to the company which had ordered for it. So the zero defect thing came in by Crosby. Ishikawa was more known for the fishbone analysis. I have a diagram which will show. And Ishikawa helps also to deal with all the detailing of the different problems and analyzing the different parts of the problems and then coming up to a closure as to how do you can deal with the problem. Just in time is exactly if a deadline has been given to you, how do you meet the deadline in that particular period of time with no excuses? That is one of the criteria, again, by the Japanese. Now, we also have the ISO certifications, which we comply when it comes to total quality management. Now, let me tell you, with regard to total quality management, every company has a ISO certification team or a different department which talks about quality assessment. In fact, with regard to even education sector, we have a quality circle. So Odisha State Open University has it, NLU has it, as well as Xavier University. It is a mandate by UGC where we have the quality circles, where we give reports to the different accreditation that we have, that what we have done in different criterions, and then how we are thinking of upgrading ourselves. So this is very important, where we ensure both quality and quantity. And the quality and quantity is not only the sole responsibility of the TQM department alone, but also with regard to the other people involved in the entire process. Now, this is an example of a fishbone diagram where you would, this is an, a problem based on with regard to why does a particular restaurant is not functioning in, well in a particular geographical location. So everything bifurcation has been done. Like if you see, look into the machine part, again, in the machine, there has been several bifurcations with regard to storage, poor hygiene, poor maintenance. With every broader problem, there are different flaws being taken out. And again, the exact reasoning as to validation with regard to every problem or every subsequent problem has been analyzed. And then you come up with a solution. I think with that, I would sum up with my class and I would straight away go to the question answer session. So I'll go back here. If there are any queries, kindly put in your queries in the chat box so that I can address them.
Dear learners, dear participants, please, I feel, let us know if you have any questions, any doubts. Now we are open for discussion. If you want to ask any specific question to our resource person, then you can unmute your mic and you can have a discussion directly with Dr. Ajay Lokar. Please go ahead and let's discuss. I request Swati Mohanty, please stop sharing your screen. Please do it immediately. Press the stop presenting option. Or else, I would like to request our technical team kindly remove her from this room so that we'll have a meaningful discussion without any disturbance. Yeah, thank you. We have one question. Yes, please go ahead, ma'am.
I think it is with regard to Sameer Swain, who is talking about ISO certified company. Yeah, like say for example, like you have to apply for international standards with regard to your international organizational standards with regard to your products or the services that you are dealing with. So if you get the ISO certification, definitely, which is a mandate, so it becomes easier for the company when it comes to the quality check. Now, there are rules and regulations with regard to any, like say, for example, if I think of coming up with my own restaurant or with regard to any food truck facility, I first thing that I need to do is, apart from the structure and hierarchy, I need to look into that what are the laws or the rules with regard to opening of this kind of a venture. So when I'm doing that, what like you have Food and Regulations Authority, which will have a quality check with the kind of product or the processed food that I'm giving to my customers. Is it quality oriented or not? We need a food license, definitely. So for that, for the different products and services that you deal with, so for everything, there is a quality check that is happening. We have... okay, I think I spoke only in English. I think that was one criteria. I think I should include Hindi as well. Then we have, I think, Samrat here. How do we measure and develop infoware of a firm? Now, it depends upon the kind of firm. Now, say, for example, infoware, which talks about knowledge, skills, and your technological support, you need to look into what is the current trend in the market. Now, keeping that in mind, you need to upgrade yourself with regard to, if you want the quality to be maintained with regard to your knowledge, with regard to anything that you are doing. So for that, the infoware has to be taken into consideration. So there are quality assessment cells in everything, every department or any organization who will, with regard to your infoware, they will keep a constant suggestions is taken, which we have something also in your audit mechanisms. So there, what we do is the audit or the suggestive teams, they give you different options as to how you can include. So be it NAC accreditation or be it, you know, any of the quality circle accreditation with regard to your universities. Say, for example, they take into account what is the e-library facility being given, what are the different softwares that has been provided, what are the different access to different kinds of journals, e-library functioning. So keeping all, and what are the internet facilities, what are the different kind of things to be required, knowledge required, what is the skill required. So keeping all this thing in mind, the, you know, the assessment and the reviews are frequently done. There is any other question? Yes, now here when we talk about, now this is again an issue. Like, say, for example, as rightly pointed out by Mr. Swami, I think, he talks about that. Just let me check over the question. Yes, Maharatna and Abharatna and Miniratna companies. Yes, there is a problem because there is a government intervention. Now, if you would have heard about the recent, disinvestment happening in various, we have NALCO, who faced the challenge with regard to being a Abharatna company who is doing really well with regard to the alumni business. Why is it thinking of disinvestment in with regard to different stakes? Now, there was a huge, even I think a PIL has been filed, that why a public sector undertaking, which is doing really well, why are they going for disinvestment? Or what would happen to the employees there? What will happen to the workers there? So keeping all this mind, there are different laws and regulations with regard to which the company needs to abide by. Now, say for example, in the Industrial Dispute Act, if there is a lockout or a closure happening, or with regard to disinvestment, what is the appropriate authority who will give you the the consent that yes, a closure can happen? Then what are the different criterions under which a closure or a lockdown is happening? What is the time period being given? So all these things have to be taken into consideration, because you randomly cannot decide a Maharatna company or a Navratna company to go on for a disinvestment. So if there is a reason, what is it clearly mentioned, the consent given by the appropriate government and the authority, and then we can go about executing it. And all of them have, with regard to the TQM or with regard to, the total quality thing, they have to be taken into consideration. Yes, Anurag, we have a question with regard to customer satisfaction. Customer feedbacks is therefore a complete mandate with regard to any sort of a thing. Now, right now, the fact that I am taking a class, you will definitely give a feedback about it, be it in TQM, be it in anything. For any need assessment, when a process is being identified, a need assessment done, execution of it has been done. So post that, a feedback or an evaluation mechanism is definitely enhances the quality and the quantity of the work. Now, obviously, the feedback that I got that with regard to English and Hindi. So how do I improvise with regard to that, bringing in more of Hindi rather than English? So, these inputs definitely help a lot. And customer satisfaction definitely plays an important part with regard to the feedback mechanism in TQM. And that's the reason I would again bring in here, there is also a consumer forum. If you are dissatisfied, you can always, go into the consumer forum where even if you are not satisfied with a particular course also given by a particular university for which they are charging hefty amount, you can definitely go to the consumer forum and ask that why was this not being given. If that accreditation or the degree is, we see a lot of, frauds being happening. So there is a consumer forum also to address this.
And there are two more questions.
I am not able to see it here. Okay. Now, how do we know if the company is legal? Your certification, first of all, with regard to Companies Act, the registration of the company is a mandate. Now, the Companies Act and what is the memorandum of association there that has to be certified legally? You have to bring in those checklists. So then only you can know whether a company is legally certified. So you have all the clauses in the Companies Act. You can very well go through it. Now, if political people training and accountability in, is political people training? Okay. I wish it was some. Sort of a training being given to the political or accountability and government sector, definitely they would be it any political agenda that you plan up for, you are accountable for it. You just cannot say that when you are a people's person, you are being elected, being a MLA or an MP or a nominated member, and your presence matters. So definitely you need to be accountable with regard to it. And what sort of a training being given at that level is definitely a question mark. We can file RTIs and find out as to how many trainings are being given to the different sectors with regard to the political people involved in it. I think globalization, So what do you want? This is a very Google question with regard to globalization. So what exactly do you mean? How do you relate to it? So it could be. Where you are represented globally with regard to your presence is around in the whole world, that maybe makes sense with regard to.
Mr. Samir, if you would like, then please unmute your mic and have a discussion with ma'am.
Is he there or we have any other questions?
Samir, please unmute. Mr. Samir Swain, please, that can be only possible at your end. Please unmute your mic and anyways,
I would like also like a very pertinent thing that I would like to share with all my participants is whenever you are relating to any topic, do not read the topic with regard to just understanding the concept. You need to if you are taking up any topic for that matter, you need to go into the history, the review of literature, how it did evolve. What are the different parameters? What are the current situations? So you need to, intermingle with a different quarters as to where it can percolate and how it can be executed. So what are the practical usage of it? Because it doesn't, I feel that if you are not executing a particular theory into action, it has how do you go about it without understanding the different differences of it? So every participant, whatever we discussed here, I would request you please again go back, read the guidelines, read it with regard to the redeployment and reskilling, read the ministry guidelines, read the labor law practical, because in just 1.5 hours it's very difficult to have getting into the details of every minute thing, so which requires a lot of subsequent readings. What you have been given is very basic with regard to the blocks, but along with that you need to read it with how do you relate it to the current situations. If there is any other question.
Yes, ma'am. There is one more question from Vanti Krishna. Isha.
Globally, we are right now, when we talk about the economic recession, it is going to be very difficult. Now, economically, we already saw, people are, are in fear. Definitely, they are. Reliance, if you've seen the news, it is already given a 50% pay cut. Then there are abroad, US has, given bailouts for a lot of people, non-residents, Americans there. So globally, everyone, because there has been a complete cessation of work and people are right now in panic. But yes, the government will take its own time, but then reviving would take, we are actually, if you ask me, we are again going back 4 years back. So reviving would be difficult, but then there are different means as to what sectors right now need to be first, taken care of, and then subsequently, it will take its time, but it will rebound definitely. Let me check.
Mr. Sameer, could you now unmute and have a discussion? Please do it, or else we'll close the session. Mr. Sami Swain. Maybe he is experiencing some technical, or if you are comfortable, maybe. Mr. Sameer, please write in the comment
section. I think he has left. Sami Swain has left the meeting.
Okay, ma'am.
Maybe there's some problem there technically.
Yes. So if there are no questions, then I take this opportunity to thank the resource person, Dr. Ajay Lopa ma'am. She has been absolutely pinpointed and she has given very pertinent examples, case studies. She has not only discussed the theory part of it, rather she has also emphasized on the practical application in corporate and in different setup, the basic human resource management aspects like training, development, redeployment, reskilling, total quality management. So all these things have been discussed in this session. Thank you so much, ma'am, for being a resource person and accepting our invitation and delivering both the sessions excellently. Thank you so much. I also take this opportunity to thank my colleague, Mr. Vigneshwar Raut, Mr. Khiro Chandra Maharana, then our technical team, Mr. Abhinandan and Ms. Sumita. Both of them have been working very hard to maintain the sanctity of our classroom, because most of our learners, participants, they also are very new to this platform, and the inquisitive mind tries to experiment with what is happening and how it is happening. So it is both of their job to make sure things are smooth. Thank you so much, each and everyone, and my other colleagues at Odisha State Open University. Yes, recorded Ayush is asking about recorded version of the lectures. Like I have told you, our multimedia team, Abhinandan is also a major part of it. So they are also limited by resources, because most of the hardware, software, it is available in our office, and office is locked down. So maybe very soon, within a week time, we will edit it. We'll upload the final output within 6-7 days. I'm anticipating this. So please keep visiting our website. There are a lot of learning resources, other learning resources like study materials, reading materials. Then we also have a lot of video lectures. We also have opened up our online learning management platform, eGyan Jyoti. There are a number of skill development courses. Those are made free and available for enrollment for all. So it is open for everyone. You can, any of you can register yourself as a learner, and you can complete a course. It is all the programs or the courses are made self-paced. You can decide your pace, time and space. And ultimately, certification is also available. If you successfully complete your sessions or course, you will get a participation certificate and a completion certificate. So these are the things what is keeping all of us at Odisha State Open University vibrant. The entire machinery of the university, starting from our vice chancellor to all of us and everyone in the team, we are all working. And believe me that we are working more than we used to work before lockdown. So thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you to our technical team and participants once again. And we look forward to further interaction. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
So this is the official announcement that the session has come to an end. I request all the participants to kindly disengage from the platform. This is the end of the session on HRM today. Thank you so much for your participation and discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Stay safe at home. Please disengage, log out.